The old ways have failed miserably. Out with the conservatives and in with the radicals. Out with the plans for compromise and in with the plans for the sword.
In 1983, the far right declared war on America, and this is the story of what happened. Until this point in 1983, the far right more acted as vigilante actors on behalf of the state rather than people trying to oppose it. The Klan in coastal Texas, the neo-Nazis in Greensboro, and the long history of vigilante action, lynching, were all sort of done as an idea of enforcing the law or enforcing the rules of the state. Sometimes they found themselves at odds with the state. The Klan, for example, in the South during the Civil Rights Movement, were trying to stop the enforcement of America's laws. But by and large, even when they had disagreements, there was not an idea that they needed to overthrow the federal government. That was until a meeting which occurred in the summer of 1983. The new right was coming to power. In America, Ronald Reagan was president now and was starting to round out his first term. The new right had sort of come to power on this wave of anti-statism. Government is the problem, not the solution. But now the mainstream right betrayed that by becoming the establishment. They were in power now. They were the government. And yet the white ethnostate wasn't being made. What's up with that? So some people, like Klan leader Louis Beam, came to the conclusion that there was no way, peacefully anyway, for their political goals to come to fruition.
It is pure fantasy to imagine the Klan as a broad-based political movement that will obtain the numbers requisite to effect peaceful political change.
And to discuss this new direction, this revolutionary change within the white power movement, we will have to go to a very important meeting which occurred in rural Idaho in 1983. This event was called the Aryan Nations World Congress. It's not the first one. It wasn't the last one, but this one was very pivotal. The Aryan Nations World Congress was something between a far-right racist political rally, a hardcore evangelical church service, and a camping trip. People played volleyball, people set up tents, young men and young women met each other. There were speeches from white supremacists from around the globe. And in one inconspicuous house, there was a heavily guarded, heavily secret meeting. So much so that the details of the meeting don't really come through. Nobody who has been in the meeting itself has, been arrested, or if they have been, they haven't spilled their guts over what happened. But reportedly, this was the meeting in which leaders from neo-Nazis, the Ku Klux Klan, and various far-right militias around the country decided to talk about revolution. Specifically revolution against the American federal government, which they've now defined as the Zionist occupational government, which you'll probably often hear in far-right internet spaces by the acronym ZOG. And in this moment, they decided that their plan was to overthrow the American federal government, or at least wait for it to collapse in nuclear fire. In the meantime, they were there to destabilize and put together an army that would set up the white supremacist government that they had been hoping for all these years. They wanted to incite a race war by undermining the American currency, destroying or sabotaging public infrastructure, assassinating federal agents or federal judges, or, if it was possible, trying to secede a section of the country to create a white ethnostate. Before we go into that, I'm just going to quickly talk about this video sponsor, Skillshare. Skillshare is a learning community where millions come together to better themselves, to learn new skills, and, move into new career spaces. A lot of us are stuck inside with not a whole lot to do, so this is a great way to sate your boredom, but also improve yourself. Common topics include illustration, design, photography, and with the yearly subscription, it costs less than $10 a month, which is, a fairly fair price, especially because this year they've been on a kick of trying to release a whole lot more original classes, and some of them are really, really good. For example, one of the favorite courses I took was on visual storytelling by Sean Dykink. I have been a YouTuber for years, and editing has always been a thing I kind of learned autodidactically, but this course taught me more about how to think like a video editor than any of the video editing classes I've taken in the past. And the first 1,000 people who use the link in the description can get
a free trial of Skillshare Premium membership.
So thank you to Skillshare for one, asking no questions about what topic my videos are going to be about, and two, for making a video like this, which will probably most definitely be demonetized possible. After this declaration, the white power movement was now an army, a militia, if you will, trying to overthrow the American government. And one of the places where they, you know, had this idea in the back of their head to try and build this white homeland that they might be able to secede through is the whitest part of the United States, which is the Pacific Northwest. A lot of these militia movements set up shop in places like Oregon, Washington, and Idaho. And this is why there's still a lot of white supremacist activism in these states to this day. And bringing these people together, living in rural compounds, sticking with each other, created relationships, communities, even families. In an attempt to grow the white race, they even condoned polygamy, you know, to create as many children around all of these weapons of war as possible. And the principle that this organization was built under was something called leaderless resistance. You've probably heard of this before, cell-style organizing, where multiple groups are not directly communicating with each other, but are focused on a single goal. The reason you probably heard of this is because this is actually a common technique that a lot of communist guerrillas have used around the world. Because if there's one thing I'm learning about white supremacists and the far right is that they don't have great imagination, so they love to steal ideas from the far left. And one of the main organizers was a man named Louis Beam, who, if you remember from my previous video on the subject, was a Klan leader who brought his military training from Vietnam home with him, and in a one-man crusade to convert the far right into a army, a militia, brought a lot of his training to the white supremacist world. The idea was they were going to set up 600 or so of these militia cells that would be scattered around the country, usually in pretty remote areas. The idea behind this, because it was the 80s, to locate them in places where they'd be hard to get to and far enough away from population centers that they would be out of the range of atomic weapons from the Soviet Union if the Cold War ever went nuclear. Because they knew that they couldn't just overthrow the American military with, you know, 600 cells. So what they decided to do was train, destabilize, try to create the conditions for societal collapse. And then when something happens, like the federal government falls apart, or the Cold War goes hot and the United States gets nuked, that they could then activate and try to fight their war and set up their white ethnostate in the chaos. Of course, this post-apocalyptic idea sort of was sidelined after the Cold War was over, and instead their focus became entirely on federal tyranny. This network also had a large and very active cohort of women involved. The organization was highly patriarchal, and women were most definitely made subservient in these things, but they did have a practical role. They did manage many households, but also covered for their male counterparts with the law. They took care of children. They maintained their safe houses. And it's a really big part of the story that I think I'm gonna have to make its own video. It'll be an interesting experiment, because if there's one thing that Step Back viewers seem to love, it's videos about white supremacists. But if there's one thing that Step Back viewers don't seem to like to watch, it's videos featuring women. So see how those two combine. Oh boy. But how do you organize a leaderless resistance? How do you figure out when to attack? What are the orders? How do you do things? And the way that it would work is that they would have similar ideas. They would read the same books. They would read the same pamphlets. They would know all of the same techniques. So if they were all on the same page when it came to what they believed in and how they did things, then when the right conditions came up, they would act in a similar manner. So then cell A doesn't have to coordinate with cell B. Cell A just needs to publish widely, you know, freedom of speech, literature, about, you know, different ideas and white nationalism and racist organization and how to commit guerrilla war. And they would just need to read it so that everybody would be, you know, up to date and sort of the general zeitgeist would just work out for them. Instead of communicating directly, they would find like less direct ways to have ideas spread between each other. You know, online message boards and the very, very early internet. there would be, you know, common attendance at conferences or at political speeches, personal relationships, or common pieces of culture in the zeitgeist that would express political ideas and how-to manuals for techniques on how to commit this guerrilla war they're into. And one of the most influential of these works that would inform and teach members of the militia movement is a book called The Turner Diaries. So what is The Turner Diaries? The idea of the book is that it is a diary from a fictional future about how the revolution occurred that created the white utopia that they're all living in now. So the events that are outlined in the book are a white supremacist's idea of how to commit this kind of warfare and what they'll do when they take power. And what they do when they take power involves a lot of using nuclear weapons on people of color, ethnic cleansing, mass hangings of people who are in interracial relationships, and of course, genocide of the Jewish people. If you want to go more in depth about what this book was about and the sort of things within it, I would really highly recommend the video by Thought Slam on the subject. I'll put a link in the description down there and somewhere around here, because he did a really good job and I really don't want to step on any of his toes. What I'm going to do is expand on the stuff that he talked about, because while he did a really great analysis of it, there's one thing that he kind of went into but didn't go super far into, which is that the Turner Diaries, while being a novel and kind of a shitty novel, it's not that interesting or compelling of a story, what it is a wrapped in fiction how-to manual for committing guerrilla war against the state, or at least what the author thought would be the way to commit guerrilla war against the state. And you know me, I'm stuck down this rabbit hole of understanding narratives, and the Turner Diaries does foundationally, and this is probably why it's like so overwhelmingly popular with these people, it creates a common narrative for all of these different white supremacists who might have come to the movement through the Klan or through Nazi movements or through all of these different far-right ideologies. It gives them a common story that brings them together under a cause and shows something for them to strive towards. So in this book, the white power movement builds through a sort of white supremacist version of propaganda of the deed. They commit key assassinations, acts of sabotage, and in doing so, not only create instability, which they believed would mean that the people of color would just start causing chaos, in which white people would become alienated, and then they could sop up and start, you know, recruiting amongst those people. And step by step, how they do that is all laid out in the Turner Diaries. And I can't underestimate how popular this book is in both the white power movement and in mercenary circles. The book was advertised in the mercenary magazine Soldier of Fortune, which had a wide circulation and was very popular amongst not only white power types, but people who were involved with different types of mercenary groups. Louis Beam, the person who I brought up several times, even went by the nickname Turner in a lot of his code word communications. The other thing that the white power movement used to organize itself and to grow was that they were one of the first successful adopters of early computer networks. This is the 1980s, so we're not quite at the internet yet, but the technology that would build the World Wide Web was developing. And the mid-80s was around the first times that you could actually buy a personal computer. And without knowing how to assemble a computer yourself and without being super, super tech savvy, you could do some things on it. The white power movement put together its own computer network, something called LibertyNet, which they could connect to through phone lines. And on LibertyNet, they could set up message boards that were, you know, password protected and used a lot of code words so that these leaderless cells could communicate with each other and coordinate organizations without leaving any sort of paper trail. Because, you know, in the mid-80s, police were most definitely not going to be able to understand how to do stuff with computers. But on top of, like, paramilitary actions like, you know, assassination boards, it also had stuff like personal ads, pen pal programs, a lot of things that were designed so that if you were in the white power movement, you know, if you were in the cult, that all of your social interaction would be built around being in the white power movement. So everyone you dated would be in the white power movement. All of your friends would be in the white power movement. And with the online message boards, you could do a lot of communication with white power movement members around the country. And this was also very successful in getting hate literature into Canada. I'm Canadian, so I have to mention this. Canada does have, in its constitution, a ban on hate speech. So while you couldn't publish copies of the Turner Diaries in bookstores in Canada, what you could do is take the text of the Turner Diaries, put it on a, you know, digital file, and send that through these early computer networks to Canada, where they could read these things and get this literature. And the police in Canada were not going to be enforcing all this stuff about digital stuff because, you know, they don't even get it today, let alone in 1985. The problem, though, is that these computers and this network were really expensive. So the white power movement needed lots and lots of money, because not only are computers and networks expensive, but so are guns, bullets, Rottweilers, you know, all the things you need to maintain a hate group ready to tear down the federal government in order to install a white supremacist utopia. And the ways that they decided to do that was basically through crimes. The main way that they would launder money so that, you know, the prying eye of the FBI would not get involved was that one of the common organizations in the white power movement were Christian identity churches. I have mentioned Christian identity before on Step Back in my hate groups video. The TLDW version of what Christian identity is it's sort of branch of hardcore evangelical Christianity that focuses on white supremacy and anti-Semitism, and fairly often, these Christian identity churches are highly involved with the white power movement, and to the point where they were literally laundering money for the movement via donations. A common recruiting ground for the white power movement was the prison population. The 1980s, the prison industrial complex is getting going in a real big way. And so there's tons and tons of prisoners in these prisons. And a lot of these people, when they come out, are going to have no prospects for the future. So if you can go in there and say, hey, I'm going to protect you, give you resources, and all you need to do is be more and more sympathetic to white supremacist ideas, you're going to do pretty well. And so the white power movement either created or became associated with the Aryan Brotherhood, which is a prison gang that continues to exist to this day. They'd recruit white prisoners who would not only be in prison helping raise money to donate to those churches, but at the same time, when they got out of prison, they would then funnel right into these white power cells. Because when you get out of prison, there's not a whole lot of prospects for you. It's not really easy to get a job or, you know, make any progress in your life. And these white power people would welcome them in with open arms. The main ways that the white power movement raised money was through counterfeiting, the printing of fake money. They also liked doing this because they felt like it undermined the Federal Reserve and the sort of federal government's monetary system. It was almost an act of economic sabotage, and at the same time, they got to make cash. Another thing they did was just straight up robbery. They would rob banks, they would rob armored cars, and walk away with absurd amounts of money. Through their hyper-moralistic lens, they could justify robbing banks and armored cars as, you know, just saying that, oh, the banks are owned by ... them, so it's perfectly fine. Another way that the leaderless organization could work is that the uniform was standardized, but also you didn't need to buy anything fancy. Getting a Klan robe, while I've never done so myself, is probably an involved process. But to join the white power movement, for example, one terrorist group called The Order, you could buy everything you needed for their uniform at like a department store. Sort of similar to the uniform style of the Proud Boys. Isn't that a weird coincidence? And on top of crimes for profit, they would also try to do random acts of violence. One of the more high-profile crimes the white power movement committed in the 1980s was the murder of Alan Berg, who was a Jewish liberal radio host in 1984. There was also a famous bombing of the Embassy Theater, which was a Seattle pornography theater. You know, random stochastic terrorism like that. But one of the more important flashpoints to identify where this movement was and where things were going happened in 1984 in a place called Whidbey Island. So before they were thoroughly infiltrated, the FBI and the ATF and Secret Service, because of the counterfeiting, were pretty involved in trying to take down the white power movement. And through an FBI informant, they were able to find the location of Robert J. Matthews. Matthews himself was a neo-Nazi, and when the FBI went to arrest him, he managed to shoot his way out of an arrest. While escaping, notably not shooting the white FBI officers, as per the instructions of the Turner Diaries. His escape led to a manhunt in which he made his way towards one of their safe houses, which was located on Whidbey Island. The government eventually found this house, and when they finally arrived, it led to a 36-hour standoff between Matthews and over 100 federal agents. Several agents attempted a raid in which they burst through the bottom floor. Matthews went up to the top floor, and in order to give the agents some vision, a helicopter above dropped a few flares down so that, you know, that they could see. The house, though, was filled with explosives, and these flares set off some sort of cache of explosives. Not exactly sure what happened, but the house went up in a huge fireball. The agents were able to escape, but Matthews was killed. And from that point onwards, Matthews became a martyr to the white power movement, to the point where members of the movement even made annual pilgrimages to the place where he died. Federal organizations tried several attempts to arrest high-profile members of groups like the Order, and while some of them were arrested and got some very severe sentences, they were never able to really contain the growth of these organizations. Try as they might, they were never able to recover all of the money stolen, and these organizations continued to grow their war chest and recruit new members. And while law enforcement knew this was a large and collected organization, journalists and the public at large would treat each of these crimes as unconnected lone wolves. Which, you know, that seems kind of familiar, doesn't it? Instead of seeing the white power movement committing acts of terrorism, they would see each of these crimes as just, you know, errant madmen. And the state was fundamentally unable to stop this organization based on a desire for ethnic cleansing and genocide and a strict racial hierarchy from growing. And so this is just the beginning. Shit. If you're interested in how this alliance came together in the fires of the Vietnam War, I highly recommend you watch this video, and I'll see you guys next time.